Hi, this is Bruce McConnell with Locomotive Systems Training. Glad you came back to work with us again this week. Today I'm going to talk a little bit more about the Federal Railroad Administration, which we kind of touched on towards the end of last week's show. So last week, remember, we talked about what is the FRA or Federal Railroad Administration. They're a branch of the federal government. Their job is to ensure safe operation of trains, both freight and passenger, throughout the United States. They are the regulatory body of the federal government, and they have rules and regulations that the railroads all have to comply with to ensure that everything is safe. Safety is a key point with the FRA. So, again, Federal Railroad Administration, Episode 9, LSTV-009. Okay. Way back in the beginning, I think it was the first video that we actually shot, we started out with what is the front and back of a locomotive, the left side, the right side, the top, the bottom. Well, top and bottom is pretty obvious. Anyway, but I told you all that the way a locomotive is identified, front to rear, left to right, is by the letter F. Every locomotive has one, and it's a requirement in FR rules, which we'll get to in just a minute. The F has to be visible, it has to be legible, it has to be readable. So let's go ahead and move on to the next slide. We'll go right past this. And by the way, you're in for a treat, because what this is actually part of the FRA program that we teach. All right, let's take a look here. This is class purpose. The purpose of the FRA locomotive inspection class is to explain what the difference is between a compliant and a non-compliant locomotive. We will discuss definitions at the beginning of each chapter section and how they apply to the regulations. You'll also see pictures of components of a GP-15-1 and of a GP-38-2 locomotive, and we'll identify what each component is and describe its function. We'll cover what FRA regulations apply to each locomotive discussed in the class, and we will also review what defects to inspect for when looking at each of these components. We will also discuss numerous schedules, different schedules of civil penalties. That's right, civil penalties. And what the difference is between a violation and a willful violation. As a class, we will perform a mechanical and FR inspection on a locomotive and review the results. So, a lot of information to look at, a lot of things to consider when you're in this class. Now, again, these are two EMD locomotives, GP-15-1 and a GP-38-2. And here's the designation as it's written on the cab of that locomotive, okay? And again, if it's there, it should be legible and needs to be readable. But we'll get into the specifics of each rule, and then we'll also dip over to the actual FRA regulation and compare that along with the guidance to make sure that we have a clear understanding between defect or condition and what the FRA is looking for. Sound like a plan? All right, let's move on. Class objectives: by the end of this class, the student should be able to review the definition section of each subpart. If listed, remember what we told you in the last class, there's different subparts. Some have only a few areas that they discuss, others have quite a few. So each subpart is different than the next one. So we got to talk about those. Explain how each definition applies to the regulations, describe the name of each component, visually indicate each component or picture. Explain the function of each component, list each FRA rule that applies to each component, describe the defects associated with each component, describe the difference between a compliant and a non-compliant locomotive, and explain the difference between a violation and a willful violation, and last but not least, perform an actual inspection on a locomotive and review the results. All right, so that's what the class is all about. And by the way, it's a two-day class, a day and a half inside the classroom, one half day outside in the locomotive, actually physically inspecting a locomotive. All right, let's go to the next one. All right, I chose this one here, FR Rule 229.21. It's called the daily inspection. Now, I might get a little bit out of sync, because remember in the last video we taught Rule 229.45 and RG. We're now at 229.21. Okay, this is how I inspect a locomotive. And Bob Daly might inspect it different. Brian might inspect it different. We all may inspect it different. But the key is, It doesn't matter which way you inspect a locomotive, as long as you inspect it the same way every time. I myself start in the cab of the locomotive. Bob might start at the front end. Brian might start at the back end, or underneath, or on top. It just doesn't matter. What does matter is that whatever you inspect, or how you inspect, you do that same thing every time. That way you don't miss anything. All right, so let's take a look at the daily inspection. A lot of confusion and misunderstanding of what a daily inspection is. So we're going to give the Federal Railroad Administration their word for word. This is right out of the FRA rule book. Remember that book I showed you in the last video with the little red cover that said 75th anniversary? This is word for word right out of that book. So let's take a look at it. It says here, A, except for MU locomotives, and MU stands for multiple unit. That's where they take two locomotives, physically, mechanically connect them together with couplers, and at the same time they'll run air hoses, pipe 13, pipe 30, pipe 20, brake pipe. They'll tie them all together pneumatically, and also they have electrical, great big 27 pin jumper cable that will go from this locomotive to that locomotive. That's called MU, or multiple unit, and it could be 2, 3, 4, 10 locomotives if you wanted in that. Okay, so it says, A, for each, except for MU locomotives, each locomotive in use, and that is a key point, in use, shall be inspected at least once during each calendar day. A written report of the inspection shall be made. So in other words, when you're going to go out, and if you're going to check, if you're going to inspect that locomotive, you don't just inspect it. There has to be an actual written report of that inspection. Okay? The report shall contain the name of the carrier, which would be the name of the railroad, the initials, like if it was Union Pacific, it'd be UP, or if it was Burlington Northern Santa Fe, it'd be BNSF, or if it was CSX, it'd be CSX, but you get the drift of it, okay? The name of the carrier, the initials, the number of the locomotive, usually it's a four-digit number, usually, the place, date, and time of the inspection, and also a description of the non-compliant conditions disclosed by the inspection, and a signature of the employee making the inspection. A lot of information in that little statement right there. Except as provided in Rule 229.9, which we'll talk about later, that's the use of non-compliance, moving a locomotive in a non-compliant condition. Rule 229.137 and Rule 229.139, any condition that constitute non-compliance with any requirement of this part shall be repaired before the locomotive is used. That's right there in black and white. Except as with respect to conditions that do not comply with Rule 229.137 or 229.139, a notation shall be made on the report indicating the nature of repairs that have been made. So up here, you inspect the locomotive once every day. If you find any non-compliant defects, you put them in a report, and then you got to make sure that the locomotive has the necessary repairs made before that locomotive is put back into service. Okay? Repairs made for conditions that do not comply with Rule 229.137 or 229.139 may be noted on the report or in electronic form. A lot of railroads nowadays have gone from what they call a hard copy inspection report, where it's actually an electronic report. You go out and do the inspection, you note whatever defects are on that locomotive, you come in, you actually put it into a system for the shop that they have. No, number one, that's your method of giving them a report, and number two, notifying the company this locomotive has this many type of non-compliant defects. The report shall be filed, the person making the repair shall sign the report. The report shall be filed and retained for at least 92 days in the office of the carrier at the terminal from which the locomotive is cared for. A record shall be maintained on each locomotive showing the place, date, and time of the previous inspection. So now we'll go ahead and let's finish reading the rest of the rule. Let me explain how that works in the class. What I do, because we're still on the daily inspection, there's more to this rule than what we're showing right here. So what we do, we'll stop the video portion of it, leave it up here on the board, and then we actually take the rule book out, and then we finish reading the rule in the class. That way we have a thorough understanding of it, and then we go on. Because this is quite a long rule here. So I want to go through all of that. Then we'll go to the next slide. But for the purposes of this, we're going to stop right here. Okay, let's go ahead and go to the next slide. All right, once we got done with the daily inspection, and trust me, there's a lot more information than what we're going to show here. This is all in that FRA class. Okay, so we're going to talk about FRA Rule 229.23, Periodic Inspection, General. A, Section A, each locomotive shall be inspected at each periodic inspection to determine whether it complies with this part. except as provided in Rule 229.9, all non-compliant conditions shall be repaired before the locomotive is used. The defect is found, the shop is in the facility, the repairs get made before the locomotive is sent back out for use. Except as provided in Rule 229.33 and Paragraph B of this section, the interval between any two periodic inspections may not exceed 92 days. And I'm going to step into this. Again, that is a very important date, 92 days. That's how long this inspection is good for. Periodic inspections shall only be made where adequate facilities are available. At each periodic inspection, the locomotive shall be positioned so that a person may safely inspect the entire underneath portion of the locomotive. So that means the locomotive needs to be positioned over a pit so the entire underneath can be inspected. Fuel tank, traction motors, truck, all that stuff. Draft gear, coupler, so on and so forth. B, for each locomotive equipped with advanced microprocessor based onboard electronic condition monitoring controls, the interval between periodic inspections shall not exceed 184 days. So if I have microprocessor based electronics, then that's good for 184 days in between inspection intervals. Number two, at least once each 31 days, a daily inspection required by Rule 229.21 shall be performed by a qualified mechanical inspector as defined in Rule 229.5. Okay, the FRA lets the railroads determine who a qualified inspector is based on that rule, which we'll get to. Okay, a record of the inspection that contains the name of the person performing the inspection and the date that it was performed shall be maintained in the locomotive cab until the next periodic inspection is performed. Now let's finish reading the rest of the rule. And in this FRA class, once again, this rule is a very lengthy rule and it takes a little bit of time, more time than we have to shoot for this video here. Then we just go through the rest of that rule and it talks about everything from what's required of a periodic inspection. All right, let's take a look here. Next one. FRA Rule 229.25, test every periodic inspection. A periodic inspection shall include the following. A, all mechanical gauges used by the engineer to aid in the control or braking of the train or locomotive except load meters used in conjunction with an auxiliary brake system shall be tested by comparison with a dead weight tester or a test gauge designed for this purpose. Now, if you're in a locomotive shop watching this video, that will be a Graham White air gauge tester. It's got the little bitty CO2 cartridge. It's almost like in a gun shape. Okay, it's got a gun, like kind of a gun grip handle with a CO2 cartridge in the handle portion of it. And then it's got a test gauge, an accurate test gauge. And then you have a line that you, a plastic line that goes in and connects to the gauge that you're testing. Okay, that's what they're talking about here. B, all electronic devices and visible insulation shall be inspected. So electrically, we need to look at these devices to make sure that they are there, they're not damaged, and they're functioning properly. Okay. C, all cable connections between locomotives and jumpers that are designed to carry 600 volts or more shall be thoroughly cleaned, inspected, and tested for continuity. And again, this rule is rather lengthy, so now we're going to finish reading the rest of that rule. It's, again, another lengthy rule, more than what we do have time for this here today, but it covers a great deal of the periodic inspection that we deal with on a regular basis. So, with that being said, we kind of just stopped right here. We're right here, we have the control stands, one on the left, one on the right, and we're looking at gauges, we're looking at the other test equipment that's located on the control stand and other areas of the locomotive. So with that said, we're gonna go ahead and stop this video right now, but before I go, again, I wanna thank you for coming in and joining us today. Also, I wanna encourage you to go to our website, and that is lst-ca.com. Once again, that's lst-ca.com and check out our website. All the information on the class we have to offer are available there. Check it out. Give us a call. We'll go from there. Thank you and have a safe day.